Okay, welcome to all of you. Let me get started and get on time so we have some time for interactive discussion. The whole purpose of this session is to promote interactive discussion with all of you. So we're hoping to have some time afterwards and really want you to get into the debate of it all, not necessarily with us, but among yourselves. So my name is Mitch Shiwi. I'm the chairperson of this session. We will be using a lot of ARS technology here, so feel free to scan this so you can participate. Give you guys a minute to catch up with that. The session is about optimizing laboratory procedures. It's based on a recent IVF lab guidance that was published in FNS. So we'll be covering lab staffing, procedures, as well as quality management today. And we'll talk about that in a moment. Okay, so I'll be moderating the session with our two esteemed lecturers. I serve as a scientific advisor for a couple companies, and otherwise I don't feel I have conflicts of interest in discussing session matter today. One of our esteemed lecturers is Brent Barrett from Boston IVF. He is a chief lab director for that facility for several laboratories, and a expert in quality management, as you will hear. He has a couple disclosures and also feels he has no conflicts of interest in the subject matter today. We also have Jason Swain joining us, the corporate lab director for CCRM. Jason's a well-published individual, well-established in the industry as well, and no conflicts of interest to discuss. So again, our subject matter today is to present to you ways that we can, are we optimizing our lab practices in terms of lab teams, procedures, and quality management? And really the most important thing factoring in here is that we're all subject to change in our environments today, whether it's technological advancements, commercialism, marketing, and corporate infrastructure of changing laboratory dynamics. And really, how is this affecting our lab practices? Is standardization truly optimizing or such? So we'll discuss those issues today. Again, if you came late, we're using a QRS audio response system. Feel free to capture that so you can participate. And we'll start off with this question. I'd like to know who's in the audience today. So give us a little bit of your background. I assume mainly laboratorians. So you can start your participation now. All right. As expected, primarily embryologists, which is great. Thank you. With that, I'd like to introduce our first speaker, Jason Swain.
Thank you. So, in the vein of standardization for the laboratory, start with talking about the lab team. And I think this may be important to optimizing some of the workflows and hopefully satisfaction of the embryologists and others in the team. And so I like to start with this quote from David and Sharon Mortimer from their very well-known book on quality management in 2004. Basically, you can see from the highlighted words, it isn't a team. The IVF lab needs to be thought of as a team. It's important for success of the clinic. It requires respect, and ultimately, all of this is required for the quality that we want to see in our labs and for our patients. And so the question is, how do we build that quality and success and respect in that endeavor for the team approach? There's various personnel and various roles in the lab. There is the recent publication in Fertility and Sterility in 2022 that addresses some of this. And so most labs have a lab director. This could be on-site or off-site. That could be very relevant to building that team. And it can be impactful to other aspects in terms of standardizing and potentially optimizing that laboratory team environment. You then have kind of a hierarchy of oversight there with lab supervisor or manager. Probably some may say that there's a difference between those two titles. That might be an area of debate. And then it comes down to embryologists. And I think this has been actively discussed in various workshops and online message boards. ASRM, or that Fertility and Sterility publication, mentioned trainee, junior, mid-level, or embryologist, and senior embryologist. Although I think an argument could be made for perhaps a more neutral naming system, either five levels or even six levels, to maybe fine-tune that career ladder that people are looking for in many professions, especially within the lab, where it could be based on time or procedures learned. I think an argument could be made splitting those levels out beyond just the four designations in that publication. But I think also important and also overlooked are the various support roles that most labs need this day and age, because embryologists would like to focus on the technical aspects of embryology, but there's a growing amount of paperwork and other duties, and so lab assistants or coordinators, naming various cryologistics officer or specialist, a SART data entry person, which can be on-site or off-site, or any number of other adjunct sort of roles. I think these are overlooked in literature, but certainly important and absolutely impact the dynamics and the staffing numbers of the lab team. And so if we're trying to talk about standardization, I think there's a lot to tease out here in a lot of areas of discussion. And so that kind of brings up this first question to hopefully raise some of that debate or discussion is, should there be standardized positions or roles in the IVF lab? And might this then aid in optimization, advancement, and hopefully satisfaction of that laboratory team? So give everyone a chance to respond to that question. So it looks like, yes, I think pretty good consensus is that standardizing some of those positions would be useful on many levels. Did we want to discuss any of this in real time, or just kind of wait till the end?
No, we'll wait till the end. Okay. Just keep flowing.
Yep. So I think there's some value in that, and it looks like the audience largely agrees. And the nice thing is there is a body of literature kind of looking at this, as I referenced that 2022 manuscript. So step in the right direction. Now, in terms of staffing, a very important topic that's getting a lot of attention recently is staffing levels. And so here you can see just four publications on this topic. But again, these publications don't always get to address a lot of the nuance that's very important from lab to lab. Things like clinical scheduling, or daily schedule is arguably more impactful than the annual schedule in terms of volume. 500 cycles is not always 500 cycles if those are being grouped together, say, in a few batches during the year versus spread out evenly throughout the year. Unscheduled add-ons have a big impact, and that can vary from clinic to clinic based on workflow. The type of cycles, PGTA cycles and others, may be more time-consuming than non. How those duties are split up, the number of adjunct staff, as we mentioned in the last slide, the training levels of those staff. One FTE is not equal across all personnel. Some people are obviously more trained and more productive than others. And then rotations and how you rotate these bodies. So while we do have a growing body of literature on some staffing recommendation levels, I think there's a lot to be desired, and there's a lot of nuance that has to be considered. So here's a couple tables from some publications in 2008 you can see on the left. In terms of recommended number of cycles. You can see two embryologists is a minimum number. We can talk about that later. An additional embryologist for the next 150 cycles, an additional embryologist for the next 300 cycles. So that doesn't appear to be a linear increase there. But then an additional embryologist per 200 cycles. So that kind of varies, 150 to 300 down to 200. Update to a couple, or to last year in Fertility and Sterility in 2022, you can see that the powers that be, or the experts on this publication, revised those standards slightly. to 2 to 3 embryologists for the first 150 cycles. And I think that makes sense in terms of having staff for backup. If you've got two bodies and one person calls in, you now don't have any backup. So probably a reason for that 2 to 3, as well as increasing complexity of cycles. 3 to 4 for the next 150, 4 to 5 for the next 300, and then one additional embryologist per 150 cycles to reflect presumably that increasing complexity. So we have seen some updates to these recommendations. Whether we agree with them or not, we can probably discuss at the end. But important to note, you must consider backup and witnessing in these recommendations and build in some coverage there. I think this brings up a question of what is a cycle? This is based on number of laboratory cycles, and as I think we'll see, that definition can vary. And then really, I think a good question for us to ask ourselves, is there really a one-size-fits-all approach? Clinics operate differently on many facets, and that means laboratories do as well. And then, is this a linear relationship? Certainly by these two graphs, I would say no, based on how those levels have changed based on volume. You have efficiency with scale and size. So that poses this question for the group. What is the minimum number of embryologists to have on staff or readily available for daily staffing safety levels? One senior level embryologist, 2 people total, 3 people total, or more than 3 people? So it looks like 2 people total is what the group said, and I would agree that on any given day you need to have at least 2 people in the laboratory, but clearly in a very busy lab that number could go up. And so again, I guess an area of discussion we could have later is how do you ensure you always have 2 people, at least 2 people on every day? I would say that means you have to have more than 2 people on staff to allow for time off and other things. So looking at some other publications and tables related to lab staffing, this is a publication that was updated from the original 2010. So you can see 2010, 2021, looking at the staffing of 10 high-performing IVF centers. And you can see in 2010, in terms of laboratory personnel, it was around one lab personnel per 93 fresh IVF cycles or per 127 total IVF cycles. And in this case, total IVF cycles was defined as fresh and frozen. So fast forward to the 2021 publication, and you can see the number of embryologists has changed. One embryologist per 152 retrievals. So actually, the number of retrievals has gone up. That's interesting because that prior publication we saw a couple slides ago indicated that staffing levels should have gone up. But this is saying that embryologists should be doing or are doing in highly successful labs more cycles. And then if you look at the total cycles, fresh plus frozen, that increases, again, from that 127 to 273. So this tells me that, at least based on these 10 labs, or the 10 labs that were surveyed, embryologists are doing more, while the recommendations have been that there should be more embryologists. So I think there's a bit of a conflict in the data here. And I think this is something that most of us would say we've experienced in real world, in terms of having to do more with less. And then this is the final publication from Alpha, which would presumably have a bit of a European spin on it. They define one hands-on embryologist per 120 stimulation cycles. So we can see varying or differing recommendations in the literature in terms of optimal staffing levels. And it certainly is a moving target, and you will have different thoughts on what we should have. So here's the next question related to staffing levels. And if we can reach a recommended staffing algorithm, so to speak, what do you consider an IVF cycle? Is it a retrieval, which would include egg vits, as well as non-egg vit cycles? An oocyte retrieval leading to no embryos, any retrieval plus any frozen embryo transfers, any retrieval plus any transfer, or some other definition? So it looks like we're a bit split here. Looks like an oocyte retrieval with a fair number
split with
any retrieval plus frozen embryo transfer. So I think this kind of shows us that we haven't even agreed on what a cycle is. So if you're going to try to staff appropriately, it'd be nice to know what we're staffing against. So certainly I think something that we could work on to come to better agreement. And this is, I think, the final publication that I was able to find related to lab staffing. And this is from Fertility and Sterility with Mina Alakani and Dave McCullough and others who have really tried to look at this, I think, in a more accurate fashion based on a number of incubators and practical logistics in the lab. And really the idea being that with increasing complexity in the lab, that makes more time, that means more staff. And so you could actually download an equation and plug in your variables and come up with a recommended staffing level. Although again, whether there's a one size fits all approach is debatable. So the next question for the group is, what do you think is a reasonable IVF lab staffing model? One embryologist for every 100 to 125 retrievals, one embryologist for every 100 to 125 cycles, one embryologist per 150 plus retrievals, one embryologist per 100 plus cycles, or it's variable, it must consider various other factors. So a bit of a loaded question here, considering we didn't have consensus on the definition of a cycle, but kind of the point. It's a bit of a moving target if we don't have an agreed upon starting point. So you can see here that it's variable based on any number of considered factors, which I think is reasonable, and then next best being one embryologist per 125 cycles. So I think we're closer to an agreement than we might suspect here, but again, it'd be nice to detail or spell out some of those variables and put a finer point on this. Now, and this is a question really based on kind of social media chatter and things that have popped up on various message boards. Should there be a union formed for the IVF lab, basically with the intent of trying to standardize some of these items? Yes, no, or maybe? So might be good to have a discussion on this afterwards.
Nice color chart.
Wow.
And then I'll kind of wrap up my portion by moving from the staffing topic to procedures. You can see various quotes here, really kind of aimed at trying to tease out whether there's an optimal culture system, something that we certainly all strive for. And you can see here from Rusty Poole, mentor of mine, over 233 factors in the culture system. So if we're trying to optimize, there's a lot of work to be done there. And then from the Cairo consensus from the Mortimers and others who contributed to that publication from 2021, there's only one thing that's important in the IVF laboratory, and that's everything. So the point being is that this is not a simple task when we try to optimize culture system, and to the title of this session, might standardization help towards that goal? There's a number of lab procedures, as we all know very well, as we said, over 233 variables. Things like setup, retrieval, sperm prep, denuding, ICSI culture, and any number of procedures under those broad headings. There's various issues. As we said, there's increasing procedure number, increasing complexity of those procedures, seemingly constant push for more volume, especially with this kind of corporatization of IVF. Fewer staff for any number of reasons, and then impact on workflow of various factors. So this is an issue that we all are dealing with in the laboratories. And then to bring that back to an optimal culture system, the importance of timing. So with all those factors, something has to give, and it seems like perhaps sometimes timing gives. And if we want to prioritize the gametes and embryos as the patient and their physiology and what's best for them versus what's best for the patient in the waiting room or what's best for us as people in the lab and our sanity and safety, that's a good question to ask is how do you do what's best for the gametes and embryos on their timeline versus kind of, I guess, more real world or what's impactful to the to the embryologist and patient. So it's not uncommon to see questions like, why do retrievals occur at certain times in the morning? Why can't you move this to fit my schedule? Why do transfers occur in the afternoon? Why can't we flip-flop this for convenience? Why can't the lab adjust their schedule to make my life easier, whether that be lab, patient, physician, anyone other than the gamete or embryo? And I'd argue that, you know, there is a biological clock. You can see here from this title how the timing of biological processes is controlled at the cellular level. So gametes and embryos do have their own timing. I'd argue that for quality, adhering to that timing and catering to their needs is important versus, you know, our clocks. Our clocks are certainly relevant. We have to consider it. There is only so many hours in the day. Many procedures, often increasing number of procedures, more than one procedure per day. And so this timeline you can see here, you could add any number of boxes. As you add patients, those number of boxes increase. So coordination and timing becomes very important in the lab, as we know, to get through a day safely and to try to stay on time. We know timing is important. If we stop and think about it, Istanbul consensus in terms of time to check fertilization, day two, day three, day four, day five, there are windows of time of when cells are supposed to be in a certain area. So if we don't adhere to those clocks, then, you know, are we compromising the outcomes and the quality? And then with morphokinetics, certainly there's now an active area of debate on how timings of cell divisions are important and may be indicators of embryo quality. This is just another schedule to show kind of the importance of timing or the complexity of timing in the IVF lab, starting at 7 a.m., ending sometime in the afternoon, trying to adhere to that timing. Most labs' SOPs have recommended timings, and so you try to get the procedures done on the clock before too late in the evening. And importantly, that requires sufficient personnel and equipment to stick to those timings. And as we mentioned, to consider the effect of add-on or unscheduled procedures, because one curveball thrown at you in this day can have a cascade effect on all the patients, not just one patient. So next question, in terms of trying to standardize, and if we believe that timing has an impact on quality of the gametes and embryos, we'll pick oocyte denuding. Is there a standardized oocyte denuding time? And what might that be in terms of optimal timing? None, it doesn't make a difference. 0 to 1 hour post-retrieval, 1 to 2 hour post-retrieval, or less than 1 hour pre-ICSI. So it looks like most say 1 to 2 hours post-retrieval when you should start denuding the egg. I think that's reasonable. Most SOPs have some sort of timeline. I think the question is, are labs able to or actually adhering to those timelines? And again, the amount of volume pushed through the lab and the staffing and equipment absolutely impact that. So the nice thing is with witnessing systems and things, we are seeing some data coming out that give us the ability to track this. And I think, you know, perhaps TBD on whether there is an impact on quality, but it'd be nice to have a standard and be able to hold to it with sufficient resources. Looking at some data related to this, this is a prospective study using sibling oocytes, so a good design from 2001. Looking at immediate denuding with immediate injection with ICSI, delayed denuding of 4 hours after retrieval with immediate injection, or immediate denuding and delayed injection. In this particular study, through fertilization and blast development, they showed the best outcomes with a delayed denuding and immediate injection, indicating that there could be still a protective role, at least of cumulus cells. So this would suggest that timing might be important and that it may not just be, hey, let's fit things in as quickly as we can to get more cycles through the day, that if we are trying to consider quality, that adhering to that timing may be useful. Looking at oocyte maturation, immediate denuding and injection versus delayed, you can see some data here, again, suggesting that a delay and considering timing could have an impact on quality. So again, I think something to keep in mind as we talk about staffing and standardizing procedures, that there are various factors at play. And then, like anything, you can have mixed thoughts on this. And so this is just a sampling of studies saying that importance of ICSI timing when you do that injection post-trigger or post-retrieval, that it is important, growing body of literature saying it isn't important. So I think we could have a lively debate on whether timing of procedures in the lab is important. I think it probably depends on what you're comparing it to, what your control is, and how well controlled other variables are in your system. If you're extremely variable on your ICSI timing, you may be variable on other aspects, and it could be hard to draw a definite conclusion. In terms of standardizing to optimize, certainly no shortage of papers on optimizing embryo culture. So you can see just three titles here from speakers on the stage that have helped author. Not a simple question, though. As we said, so many variables in the culture system. So is there an optimal culture approach? No, yes, uninterrupted culture through blastocyst development at day 6 or day 7. Yes, there is an optimal approach. It's with sequential media, with a change before day 6 or day 7. Or yes, single-step culture media with a media change before day 6 or day 7. Or it varies based on the specific lab conditions. So it looks like people would say it varies based on those 233 variables that each lab kind of has to determine that based on their own data, which I think many people would agree with, that it's not just about the culture media, there are other factors. And we can talk about some of those factors. Here's just one of those variables. Incubators, any number of increasing types of incubators, presumably with better technology. You can go to the exhibit hall and look at some of these and some newer ones. Benchtop units, humidified, not humidified, varying number of chambers, time-lapse cameras or not, and even a publication trying to look at the existing literature to see is there one approach that may be better than another in terms of improving outcomes. So in terms of incubator technology, let's see if we can get a consensus amongst the group to see if standardizing incubator type is something that we might be able to achieve or have achieved. Is the best incubator a time-lapse incubator, a dry multi-chamber benchtop incubator, a humidified benchtop incubator, a box-type incubator, or there is no best incubator? It looks like most would say that there is no best incubator. And I think really the point of this is try to drive home the fact that there is no single component that would result in an optimal culture system. And it's a variety of components, and we can't get a consensus on whether a single piece of equipment is somehow vastly superior to another. So in terms of standardizing things, it's not an easy lift. Maybe we can get better. Maybe there are some systems that are more consistent than others, and that's a step in the right direction. But really then, I'll kind of wrap things up here. Looking at other approaches to facilitate improvement through standardization, can tools like e-witnessing and time-lapse help optimize lab staffing through standardizing some timing and other aspects? Will artificial intelligence help to standardize and optimize embryo selection? Can automation help standardize and optimize various procedures? So I think all very relevant questions that are getting various lectures and abstracts and data presented at this meeting. And it'd be nice to have this group weigh in on their thoughts and how this may or may not help us towards standardization and automation. So with that, I think my last question, and I'll turn it over, is do you believe about the future of automation in IVF? Yes, I support it 100%. No, I do not believe it'll save money or be more efficient. It may help standardize, but I'm doubtful it'll help optimize, or I believe automation is commercially driven and is unnecessary.
like there's a majority consensus that automation might help standardize, but doubtful whether it will optimize outcomes. Okay, so I hope that prompts you to have some things to talk about this afternoon before we move into our last component. And when you do, I want to remind everybody to please come up and use the microphone so we can hear your questions and your discussion very well. So with that in mind, I want to move into the next section about quality management and introduce Brent Barrett and give you some more material to focus on. And then when that finishes up, we'll have our discussion at the end.
Thanks, Mitch. And thanks, Jason, for a great talk. So first of all, I got the possibly more boring aspect of this. Equipment and personnel, that's all exciting and things. But I do want to spend a few minutes talking about the quality management system in your laboratory. So just first of all, looking at your quality management system, we'll define it in a moment, but excellent, good, sufficient, or fair, poor, or non-existent.
I guess the question is, before Brent starts, is how confident are you in what you have in place right now?
There you go. All right. Well, good. We got a good number of people who were good, and some was fair, and some was poor. So let's talk about this a little bit, because I direct a lot of laboratories, and we do a lot of different things in those laboratories. And I also inspect a lot of laboratories because I direct them. And I'm very interested to hear from people because I have my own thoughts about when I go and inspect labs, what's the weakest area. And I'm curious to know your weakest areas in your laboratory. So would you characterize it as document control, incident reporting, corrective action, KPI trending, ability to keep the QMS current, or all of the above?
Okay.
All right. So we can extend this a little bit and talk about all of these things. So we have 20, looks like 20%, and it's hard to read from this angle, have all of the above. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through a few aspects of it that we've found to be helpful over the years. And I just want to set the stage here by saying that a good QMS system is really your friend. We tend to focus on the embryology. We tend to focus on equipment, as Jason was talking about, and personnel. And those are absolutely critical things that we have to focus on in the laboratory, no question about it. And a lot of times what happens is the QMS or the paperwork or all that stuff gets a little bit pushed away, and we have all this urgent stuff to deal with day to day. And it's hard and difficult and complicated, which we'll talk about in a minute, to get that QMS system up to speed and running. Very, very hard. But I just want to emphasize, if you do have a good system in place, that system stabilizes everything. Once you get that system in place and it's working well, you can tweak it, of course, you always want to improve it, but it gives you a base, it gives you a foundation to build all kinds of things on. And that's really what a good quality management system can do for you. So I would encourage you in any way that you can to spend time working on that quality management system. And that part of that, to Jason's point earlier, is a staffing issue, it's a personnel issue. If you don't have enough staff, then the lab director or who's ever responsible for the QMS system doesn't have the time to deal with it and get that foundation really solidly built. So look at your personnel from the perspective not only of the technical tasks, which you have to do, but also from the perspective of the QMS system or that overarching or foundational aspect to all of these things. So one advantage of large labs and networks is they do have the resources to create and maintain these, and many people here are involved with that, and that's great. If you're a smaller lab, it's just much more difficult to do that. And I'm saying that, again, to say for smaller labs in particular, you may need that one more embryologist to come in to free up the lab director, the lab manager, to work on that quality management system. CAP is moving toward a more, over time, they're moving toward a more ISO 9001-oriented type of questions related to quality management. And I've just highlighted, these are some questions from CAP that I'm going to throw out here, or some, what I've done is just taken some of their questions and looked at them. And so first of all, a quality management system is a set of policies, processes, procedures, and resources designed to ensure the high quality of an organization's services. Again, this is your structure. This is the basement, the structure that you want to build everything else on. I'm not going to read all of this. You can read this yourself. But one of the things that is so critical in a laboratory is documents and controlling those documents and making sure that you have control of those documents. Are the procedures that are there, are they the most up-to-date procedures? You know, constantly when I'm inspecting laboratories, I see procedures where people have written things in. And sometimes they may initial them, sometimes they may date them, and sometimes they don't. What's the policy? What's the procedure? And I'll talk to people and they'll say, well, yeah, I implemented this a year ago and I'm pretty sure everybody here, you know, there's only four or five embryologists, so I think they all got it. And it's like, no, that's not the way you need to do things. You need to control these documents. They need to be very carefully maintained and up to date. And so just to give you some examples, these are a couple of examples from what we do. I'm not saying this is the right way, but this is just one way of doing it. Every document that we have throughout the entire Boston IVF network has approved by an individual there on the upper left what it is. This particular document's a work instruction about blastocyst reference. It's got a number there, that WIAE 2003, that's an ID number. So forth and so on. And then the last item down on the bottom there, printed copies are not controlled. In other words, if you print off a copy and somebody writes something on it, that doesn't count. That doesn't count. What's on your server or in your electronic medical record or whatever it is, that's the policy, that's the document. In addition, one of the things I mentioned is that CAP is moving more toward an ISO-oriented approach to QMS. So one of the approaches that ISO has had over the years is you have to maintain a control log. So every single document that you have should be listed. And this is just an example. You don't need to read it, obviously. But this just shows you this is the type of thing that CAP is starting to look for now. Are we controlling these documents? Do I know, for example, what documents I have, what is the current revision, and what is the date of that revision? Where are we at with all of this? Again, back to the comment. This is the basement. This is the structure for everything, building on top of that. And then once you get this under control, then it's easy to start making little changes to documents as you go along. So switching subjects here then to the root cause analysis and to looking at what's called non-conformances or variances or any number of different things. How do you deal with this stuff? And this is another critical component of what ISO requires. And again, CAP is moving toward this. CAP requires that you do a root cause analysis when a non-conforming event occurs. And we could spend a lot of time talking about what that looks like. That's not the purpose of our session here today. But I just wanted to go through very briefly. We're fortunate. Boston IVF is a large network of laboratories, and we have a lot of resources to put at this. So we actually have an electronic version of what we call a variance report. And you can see here, there's all kinds of different fields that you can fill out here from who it was reported by, the department, the location, the subject, so forth and so on. I won't go through this whole thing. But there are multiple pages here. So you filled out that first page when you have a non-conformance or a variance. That goes to management. What's the root cause of that? You look through your documents. Is it a policy issue? Is it a one-off with an individual? What happened during the investigation? CQI, that's Boston IVF acronym for Continuous Quality Improvement. It's a committee that we have that consists of physicians, nurses, billing people, as well as lab people. They meet once a month and they talk about any nonconformances, any issues that were significant enough to require some financial issue or something like that. And so that's what that page is. And then finally, we're trending those. And so we're looking at all of these nonconformances or variances and saying, is there a trend here that we're seeing over time? We're looking at pre-analytic, analytic, again, this is from CAP, post-analytic phases, by regularly comparing performance against targets defined by the laboratory. And here we're getting into KPIs. I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about this, but just to give you an example, again, we're very fortunate to have a lot of resources. We have a data analysis department that's able to take our data directly from our electronic medical system and create graphs like this. And so you can see, for example, this is the blast rate for all of the different laboratories that we have, not all of them, but this is part of them, that we have in the Boston IVF system. So we're able to trend this. We're able to look at it. How are we doing? What are the averages? Are we up? Are we down? That kind of a thing. This is volume. It's a huge issue. This is the clinical pregnancy rate. The last one was volume. And just looking again at a trend that we're seeing in the data. And this is absolutely critical to be able to have these kinds of things so you know when you have that variation in a month, is this a one-off? Is this really a serious thing? And you're able to track that. Okay, so back to kind of the quality management system slide. Wait a minute, we already did this, right?
Yep, but now.
I see. Okay, Mitch added this in. I see. Okay, got it. Okay, so now that you've seen that, so I guess what we're all supposed to feel bad about our quality management systems now. Sorry about that. Okay, so sorry. Thank you, Mitch.
I was trying to make it seem like you've taught them. Let's see if we have the same trend. All right. Pretty similar. So I thought maybe Brett would have discouraged you or intimidated you guys enough that you don't want him as your CAP inspector. Anyway, thank you very much, Brent. That was excellent. So it's going to move into the last discussion today, a problem that we all contend with and deal with. Probably, I think, one of our biggest problems we do contend with is cryostorage management. And the issues of space as well as tank replacements, I think, are kind of two key components to discuss in this group today. There are certainly some new tank systems like the Abiance, like stainless steel tanks are potentially more reliable since we seem to have a lot of concerns about the aluminum doors. I've recently had two doors that have failed. We managed them properly and there was no problems, but tanks, and a two-year-old tank that works perfectly well shouldn't be failing. But I think the steel tank systems may be a future. And also, are our current internal monitoring systems like temperature and level really adequate to detect these early failures? And the recent failure I had would say no. But something like external weight-based systems or temperature monitoring of the exterior walls of the tank maybe a more sensitive way to be implementing our daily or twice daily measurements. So I have this question for all of you. How is your lab handling inadequate space for tanks? Do you have a problem? You have no more room. You're barely managing space by discards. You have plenty of space, or you're managing your systems off-site and sending embryos out, or you believe that tomorrow tanks are the future today?
Wow.
Okay, no more room. That's not surprising. We're all barely getting by, so we really need to be creative going forward. We'll also talk about this one. So with your tanks, how do you define cryotank lifespans, and are you being influenced by your, say, commercial entities? Are you being and corporate entities worry about liability? Do you think tanks should be retired every 5 years, every 10 years, per manufacturer's warranty, or based on your own QA, QC that says this tank's operating fine, I have adequate records, it's performing well, and I'll retire it by 20 years, or they're good after 20 years? Okay, well, that's a good response. I like to see that, actually, because there's a lot of influence by companies that are managing our labs more and more, feeling that we have to have mandatory retirement dates, and it just seems difficult to do when you have adequately, perfectly performing tanks to take on a new tank that's maybe potentially less reliable. So open that up for discussion, too. So in summary today, question is, can we still put our patients first as we optimize outcomes, or are we being influenced by commercial entities and incorporation practices pushing for standardization? Are our administrators and our doctors being easily influenced by new technology and marketing schemes? And the point is, everybody's got something to sell, but does it mean it's better than what we already have as a proven practice? And I think it's important for us to remember, it's really important for us to validate our approaches before we, before setting them in place and ensuring they fit well. And I kind of keep pushing this point at the end. I think as embryologists, we need to remember that we and our staff are still scientists, not robots. So it's really important for us to continue to use our minds and put what we feel are best practices in place. Okay, with that, we'll open it up for questions and discussions, and please, I want to hear all of you kind of get into it and bring up your points.
Thank you for presenting all the data there. Those are very helpful for the embryologist. My name is Sung Tae Kim, and when I looked at the new the guideline and recent ASRM, I have the curiosity whether those the stepping number of embryologists is consider any duty of the partial the sperm preparation or the andrology duty is included or the only focused on the embryology duty.
That's a great question. I don't think I know the answer. I review those documents, I tend to have more questions than answers. I don't believe I've been on any of those documents. I don't recall giving any recommendations. We had an internal discussion amongst ourselves. I think we all came to relatively similar numbers, but labs operate differently. So in our labs, our embryologists prep the IVF sperm sample. So, but our embryologists in our labs don't do semen analysis or IUI preps. So our internal staffing number is variable. It's not a hard set number, but it entails a minimal amount of sperm prep for the IVF procedure, and then our level of embryology workload, which is very biopsy and PGTA heavy, very vitrification heavy, and a lot of FETs. So I would say that we at least have a standard that's similar to some of these published recommendations. Ours is based on per retrieval, not per FET, but it can get better, and we are trying to constantly refine that because not all of our practices do the same number of FETs. We've got some practices do a lot of retrievals and a lot of egg vitrification, way fewer FETs. So we've got to look at that and make sure we respond accordingly. It can't be the exact same staffing level because in the afternoons, they're not doing a fraction of the FETs as other locations. So in that particular publication, I don't think it entails doing a full andrology workload, but it may entail a modified andrology workload in terms of related to IVF. Anyone have any additional insight?
I was just going to add to that. Some of our clinics do, some of our smaller clinics in particular, do a lot of IUI sperm preps and semen analysis. And that, again, to Jason's point, that really skews it for us because our embryologists are tied up doing those things in some of our clinics and not able to get to other things sometimes, so we have to staff accordingly. It's a good question.
I just want to add to that in the sense of, I was surprised by the one slide you had that historically, like other than maybe say 2010, the numbers were lower and it actually went up per cycle. I always thought it was always a flip-flop the other because technology has become more intense, more biopsying, more ICSI, more you know, everything else, that we're going the other direction trying to add embryologists to the one of the things you brought up was the denuding, which for me is a really important thing. I have seen variables between labs that I've been at, and to me, it's for me personally, I think it's important to have the cumulus around the egg as long as possible before I ICSI. And I'm just surprised how so many programs do just build it into their time scheme. Like it's really easy just to do it an hour post retrieval, just to get it out of the way, and then when you get to the ICSIs later. And I think it's, I was curious to see your data, which was good. Okay, we have more questions, I know. I see those minds churning. Step up, please, ask questions. Come on up.
Here we go. Hi, I'm Avisa, I'm a lab director. I have a question for you. There is a trend, and you heard from lots of the embryologists that there are some toxic labs around because of the duration of the work. Sometimes people work 16 hours, sometimes you have to work all the weekend. The manager of the lab is very toxic. It's that we can say disqualified to be a manager for some reason is a manager. And there are lots of bullying things happening in the lab, unfortunately, because of the pressure of the work. And I didn't see anybody touch this topic, which caused the Z generation, which they are not as patient as our generation, my generation, I mean, they leave the lab because the situation of the work is not tolerable for people that they're not really familiar with this type of work. I work in this field for 15 years. I'm familiar with all of those pressure and suffering in the lab with the disqualified man lab manager that just only lab manager because of the they pay them lower. And these are the things that nobody talk about. I really thank you if you can just touch base at what we can do and where we are getting. Thank you.
Right, thank you for raising that point. I'm not going to answer that point, but what I want to do is I want to pull the audience at this point, everybody who relates to a new definition on toxic environment other than VOCs, please raise your hand. All right, so a third of the audience is with you. I don't think we have an answer, but I'll leave it to my peers. And anyone else in the crowd who wants to step up and comment on that, anybody brave enough to do that?
I'll start. I think this is something that people should try to discuss. So even in the corporate America, whether you, or corporatization of IVF, whether you agree with it or not, people have been put into managerial roles that maybe we weren't initially trained for. So everyone can get better. As with anything, some people are better at certain tasks than others. I think the increased pressure of volume and other things add to that. Some people handle it better than others. I would say we've got, you know, very good leaders in this room. There are very good labs. So I think sometimes the vocal minority perhaps outweighs the less vocal majority. I would say I see some very good labs out there.
Yes.
And it is a bit disheartening when you see a lot of the complaints online, but you know, I think we also have to keep things in perspective that there's a lot of good out there too. And now as an embryologist, there are options. Pay has gone up dramatically. There's a good side to some of this. There's push through for volume. There are training programs. So I think it's always good to view it through the right lens of balance, that it's not all bad. Sometimes if you are in a toxic environment, it can get easy to focus on that, but I think we've done some good things and we can do better.
Yeah,
some people are better at it than others.
My recommendation, I don't know, what do you think about this? We need some standardization for who can be the lab manager. For example, ABB has some standardization, but ASRM doesn't have anything. But like having the TS, if that is going to be most important thing, I think that this is important because then that person has some knowledge in embryology lab and pass some exam, something that we can just relate to. Another thing I think it's very important, leadership. skill. We don't have any classes from any lab director, even I have ACLD. Even ACLD lab director, that they can go there and learn about how to manage the lab. We learn everything how to manage the lab by our experience, not from the classes that probably some of the ACLD lab director, even lab manager, they need to pass those skill set before running the lab and 8 hours torture people in those labs. I'm sorry, guys, I know that you have the same scenario, but nobody wants to talk about this. And this is really important issue, and this is everyday life that we have. For 8 hours, we have to face it. And now everybody, even you guys, don't want it to touch base on it. And that is sad.
Would you be willing to volunteer time to lead a postgraduate course next year on this topic?
Yeah, yes, sir, I will. Definitely.
All right, well, we'll be contacting you. All right, I will say just on a final point on that topic, I think team chemistry is really crucial in a lab, and to the point, sometimes you have to just dismiss that person who's put in charge and be one staff less and have a more efficient, happier team and just manage through it. Yeah. So, all right, next question. Please, come on up.
So I was just wondering, my name is Ninis. I'm one of the embryologists in RMA in Long Island, and I wanted to ask these models that talk about the number of staffing. We have such a shortage in the embryology field, and we're also, the senior embryologists are also tasked with training the junior embryologists. And although we're happy to do that, it obviously is difficult when you have such a high volume lab. So do you think the solution to that are those training facilities that are opening up in different places, or is there, these models should include training time for these embryologists? Because, although I think these programs are wonderful, because, when I was a junior, I did not have the opportunity to go to programs as such, but they're also expensive. And, we might not have the time to, spare that junior embryologist to go there and do it. And also, what are your feelings about, certain programs, keep the seniors working and just doing, the very laboring tests as, ICSI and biopsy, and the juniors are only doing, the other tasks, but then also that kind of puts the juniors in a hard position, because they're always I'm always doing the dishes or I'm always doing the paperwork. How do you balance all that?
Yeah, so I'll make a real quick comment, and Brett and I were talking about this earlier, so he can give his view. I think the training courses are a great tool. I view them as an orientation. I this is controversial as part of the reason I'm going to say this. I don't believe that a training course will give me a fully trained embryologist. It'll give me a very good oriented embryologist, but it is incumbent on us in the lab, meaning the lab leadership at the local labs, to continue that training and finalize that training. And so that should be laid out in a clear plan over a number amount of time. I don't think it's a one size fits all. Some people train at different rates than others. Yeah. In terms of the seniors, I would put the burden back on you as the seniors, you have to also be willing to sacrifice your time. Now that means that the lab manager, lab director, whoever the powers that be, make that time available. Yeah. But at the same time, I've seen a senior embryologist say, no, I'm only going to do transfers. I am only going to do oocyte vit. Yeah. You could justify it, but it's, people have to take it upon themselves as well. Hey, I am going to take it upon myself to train this person. And I think, again, there are very good examples of where that's done very, very well. And I think that's where we could learn. Is looking at those labs that do it well and taking bits and pieces and applying that. And I know Brett has got a good thing that he does in his program to help address that.
Yeah, for the sake of time, I won't get into all of it. I'm happy to talk with you about it more. But just one comment is that, one of the things that CAP looks at, as well as I talked about ISO 9001, the quality standard, they look at training, they look at personnel. Those are part of your quality management system, that you're properly trained and you have the proper number of people there. And just to reiterate what Jason said. So, but I'm happy to talk more about it in more detail.
Yeah, that would be great. Thank you.
Jason, you said you have an actual number of cycles for embryologists, correct? How often would you say you fall outside of that parameters and still operate?
We have to. So if somebody quits, we're out. So the issue is you have to get up to it, which is easier in some markets than others,
yeah.
But it's a bit of a moving target. So I would say that we have fallen out. That's why Beck Holmes and I and our various lab directors, Manu and others, we try to, where we struggle is to know the plan. So yeah. What is the planned volume for next year so that we can hire ahead and staff ahead with a buffer so that if somebody goes out on maternity leave or quits, we are still staffed. So we've gotten to the point where we finally are kind of getting ahead with that clarity, where the growth curve isn't, you know, a mm-hmm. vertical line, so to speak. And so I think that's part of, I would say, part of the quality program is getting together with the entire team, because it impacts, we were talking about the lab, it impacts the OR, the nurses, the doctors, all departments feel it if the schedule and the growth isn't managed. The lab may, you know, be the canary in the coal mine because we're tracking KPIs and things. We do have some metrics, but all departments feel it. So, you know, we aim for about 150-ish retrievals per embryologist. That's a moving target based on any number of factors. And if we do fall out, we do our best. We can fly in traveling embryologists. We are finally getting there, doing much better through the hard work of all of our on-site lab directors and leads of identifying the junior people from the courses, from Debbie and Eva and everyone else, trying to get ahead and giving us some of that buffer room so that it's less and less. So we actually have operated outside of that zone, but we've minimized that time.
Now, in actually having a policy, do you feel that it opens you up maybe to more liability if something happens during a point where you were outside of what you would call your minimum standards?
Do you have a written policy that states
that? We don't have a written policy that says we have to staff the lab. Well, that's an internal...
It's not a written policy. It's more this kind of...
For budgeting purposes, exactly, and then to plan ahead to allow for that training program. Hey, how many trainees are we going to bring in to hit that target?
Yeah.
And then we may not hit that target. So we're starting to run into that with slowdowns and things. Hey, now we're staffed ahead in some of our labs, which is a good feeling to have.
Yeah.
It's not always the case.
All right, thank you.
One thing I've found beneficial is that a lot of us are getting older, right? So it's happening. And some actually want to retire. But what I have found is really a great resource to go back to some of these people and say, how should I just come back part-time? You know, cover a weekend a month, a couple weekends a month, and make some extra money. That's been a resource for us recently, especially during COVID.
Hi. Andy Miller, Kaiser San Francisco. So I have a question in terms of the staffing. When we have an offsite lab director, do you still count the lab manager as part of the embryology staff in terms of embryologists per 150 cycles?
So I think that's going to vary. We try to, not as a full FTE, as some portion of an FTE, and it varies a little bit. So yes, we do. We expect. Our lab directors are hands-on. It helps with the QC. That doesn't mean they're in the lab every day doing ICSI, or at least that's not the plan. Some of them are more often if we fall out of that staffing range. But we count them as a portion of FTE because they are capable or should be capable of stepping in. I still fly in and will do biopsies, not so much ICSIs anymore, but we should all be capable embryologists, but you can't count me or a lab director necessarily as a full FTE. I mean, again, going back to that staffing level, it's the daily staffing that, you know, can be the impactful thing, right? We may say annual retrieval rate, but if all of a sudden there's a 20 retrieval day, you know, it's all hands on deck to get through the day. So
if you could like quantify like FT, what would you put to it for like just putting the whole average?
For a lab manager?
Yeah.
Oh, it's
with an offsite lab.
Yeah, I mean, if they're doing five labs and they're completely hands off and they show up, you know, minimum four times a year, zero. If they're an on-site lab manager, I mean, it depends on how they manage their time. Are they in the lab throughout the week? I don't know. I mean, do you guys have any experience?
Well, I mean, I would jump in and just do retrievals just to take the burden off of time sometimes, but I wouldn't count myself as an FTE. I'm just helping the team so they can focus on other things. So,
I know we were talking earlier about this. There's a lot of traveling embryologists out there, and I think hooking up with one or more of those people, and there's a lot of agencies out there, not a lot, but some, that enable you to do that, and I'd encourage people to do that because that can help, you know, with weeks or you have medical leaves or maternity leaves or something like that. That can help with the staffing.
Thank you very much. I have a couple questions for my good friend here to the left, too. I just want to acknowledge David Mortimer. It was brought up in a couple of slides. David was talking about this subject 20 years ago, and we were kind of ignoring it. And it's really important. I mean, and Brett's carrying on the Mortimer of today. So David might be in a crowd, so if he is, please stand up and join us. But anyway, on a topic of control logs, I was really interested in that. And for those of us who don't really have a good control log in place, is there any, I mean, we need to start somewhere. So we start at ground zero and say today's, even though we've been revising and revising and revising, this is now document number one. This is to restart today. And what do you want to see as a cap and spec for you? We just start from ground zero and from today on, we're going to keep track of it, or we go back and try to guess?
So you're talking about document control?
Yeah. As far as a control log and when we revised it, how many documents we've had.
Yep. So this is a big issue. Again, I'd be happy to talk to anybody more in depth about it. You do have to start with some procedures and you work your way down through those. You have to set up a system that works across your laboratory or across the entire clinic, if that's what you want to do. You know, you saw we had headers and we had footers and things like that. All of that is kind of a template. We have different, so you divide documents up into different categories. You have procedures, you have work instructions, you have policies, et cetera. And so there's a lot of kind of work that goes into it. And once you have that template set up, then you start taking different procedures and you say, okay, is this a procedure? Is this a work instruction, which is basically a cheat sheet? So getting that system in place, that's what takes time. And that's what I, as an inspector, like to see. Every inspector is different, so that's just me. But everybody needs to have this idea that every document that you have is controlled. And we're not writing on it. A lot of what I see, I don't know if other people see that, is I walk into a lab, and there's things posted on incubators and do vitrification this way or that way. And I ask, is this document controlled? When was this put up? Who put this up? How do you know everybody's following this procedure? And they're like, oh, yeah, we don't really know. So they take it down. And that's fine. But that's part of document control, is you shouldn't be having things hanging up in your laboratory, for example.
Is there a good program that you would recommend to help people get started on it?
Oh, great question. There's all kinds of programs out there. We did an in-house thing, but yeah, there's all kinds of programs out there. I couldn't recommend one in specific, but yeah.
All right, my other total quality management question for you is the root cause analysis. In the day, I mean, basically I encourage my embryologists to be honest, have integrity. It's really important no matter what the mistake is, no matter what the issue is, you need to bring it to the attention of your mate and acknowledge it on paper. It doesn't have to be an incident report. So I would have, and you probably remember because I was fortunate enough to have him come devour my lab, have a problem log like specimen problems or QA problems and just the little thing like the nurses didn't schedule this, the doctor scheduled things late. Just acknowledging it and then recording it later. But with bigger companies getting involved now, there's a bigger process. There's like this multi-step root cause analysis, document control, and it's intimidating to my staff. When they make a mistake, now they've got to jump into a five-page document and spend a half hour of their time. And it seems to me it's almost intimidating to the point where now they don't want to be honest about making a small mistake.
Yes, that's a great point. And just very briefly, I think we're out of time here. Sorry about that. But just a last comment about that. I think we, as I think everybody up here does, and I'm sure all labs do, is we value transparency in all of this. And you have to make judgment calls about different variances that you have. And insignificant ones or near misses oftentimes will not go into that process I showed you earlier because it is onerous, no question about it. What that system is designed to do is to capture those situations where a patient's cycle was significantly affected. There may be a financial component involved with this. You gotta have documentation on that stuff for legal reasons, if no other reasons. But it also, even though it can take time for your staff, which I understand, I find that it helps them understand that this is important. You make a mistake, this is a big deal. I mean, a significant mistake. And I want you to take the time to sit there and deal with it. Now, again, I make judgment calls all the time about, oh, we don't need a variance report on that, or we do. So it's a judgment call, but it's not a bad thing, I think, to make people do that kind of a thing, maybe to turn your idea around a little bit. You know what I mean?
So we can have a hybrid. I mean, you can have minor things and just have a little control log that just documents it. All right, before we wrap up today, I just want to thank all of you for attending. Because this is an SRBT interactive session, I want you please to remember SRBT, it was organized for you. So we had a voice on the board at ASRM. So I really want to encourage you and your colleagues to please be members of SRBT. And please get involved. If you don't know how to get involved, contact us. There are various committees. We want you to get involved. So please contact us and don't be afraid. All right? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That was excellent.